The Chief Executive Officer of the Kio Group, Mohamed Ja, tells us more about Kodo and what's next.
Not only Gambia is in it. If you look at most of the African countries today, they have mobile money, you know, working. So we said, why not Gambia? We, you know, for Qcell, for us, since we started, our objective is to make sure we bring the best technologies to the Gambian public at the cheapest possible prices.
As the spirit of modeling reaches new altitude, we went out and about to find out who's going to be the next Senegambia model. Looking for inspiration? Check it out. One man with an ordinary bike is on a 16-year mission to travel around the world. We'll be back with these and other stories right after.
So I think I always meet good people, although very few incident was not good. But a lot of good people living in this world, they think for the world. And that is the positive and optimistic way we can make a better world. And that's not only my duty, that is our duty to make a better world. And that is the way of contribution that we need to be.
Welcome back to Weekend Spectrum. Well, as you've been following in the news, last Tuesday, he launched what many describe as a game changer. Weekend Spectrum decided to find out more from the man about what Kodo is all about.
To steadiness and determination, the Kio Group has carved a niche for themselves, and it seems there is no turning back with the task at hand. The story of how a four-man team managed to weather the storm still resonates in the minds of many doubting Thomases. Over the years, the gains registered by the company has given them the rare opportunity to enjoy positive coverage from established media organizations. Mohamed Ja's meteoric rise has inspired a generation of youths. He took time to recollect how his upbringing influenced his business undertakings.
My father is an educationist, and he was also a disciplinarian and an imam. And his role in society was to guide people to do good, to guide people to be disciplined, to guide people to be honest. So I can say that My mentor is my father. I learned a lot from him.
Last Tuesday, the Kio Group launched what many believe was a robust strategy designed to not only woo customers, but put the country on a firm pedestal as far as financial services are concerned. After the launch of Kodo, Weekend Spectrum had an exclusive interview with Mohamed Ja, who used the opportunity to explain why it was strategic to intervene.
Not only Gambia is in it. If you look at most of the African countries today, they have mobile money, you know, working. So we said, why not Gambia? We, you know, for Qcell, for us, since we started, our objective is to make sure we bring the best technologies to the Gambian public at the cheapest possible prices. For us, that's our objective. And we, Gambia, should not be left behind, you know, in this very important innovation, which if you look at most of the African countries now, you know, they have it already. In fact, to just tell you, West Africa, Gambia was the only country which doesn't have mobile money.
There is no doubt that Kodo is expected to face challenges as regards the financial viability of many customers who have little or no money to spend. I wanted him to expound on how to tackle the challenges and the accompanying benefits of the technology.
The strength is very simple. It means that with any amount of money you have, from $10, you can now have a small bank account in your mobile phone through the Kodo. So that means that with your Kodo account, is basically a moving mobile phone, a mobile wallet. It's a kalpe. That's why we call it a kalpe, you know, in our vernacular languages. So what the objective here is to make sure that the money you have, which you cash in, just like how you cash in into a bank account, that's how you cash in into the Kodo. When you cash it into your account, it's secure. And when you want to use it to do any transaction, whether you want to pay a taxi driver, whether you want to buy fish in the market, whether you want to buy petrol, whether you want to send money to somebody in the, you know, somebody somewhere, it's very easy because it's instant. And remember, you cannot send money which you don't have, because it's like a bank account. For you to be able to cash out money, you should have cashed in the money. So the subscribers are going to cash in money, but then the convenience is now that the money, nobody can steal the money. You know, it's not in paper form. It's now in electronic form. Even if that mobile phone is stolen, still people cannot access that money because you have a secret code.
If Gambian youths are looking for inspiration from the private sector, the Q Group's success story is therefore expected to stimulate budding business entrepreneurs. One thing that has spurred the Q Group is the enabling environment provided by the Gambia government for businesses to strive.
I think when His Excellency the President, you know, took over the mantle of government in 1994, I think you heard him saying everywhere he goes that the sky is the limit for Gambian entrepreneurs or for Gambian youths, you know. And he said it and he meant it. What he meant was that we should all try to contribute our quota to the development of this country, and your limit depends on you, not on him. He has opened all the doors for us. We at the Q Group seized the opportunity. We seized the opportunity. We started with four people, training people. Today we have hired thousands of people, and we have different entities doing different things. And the government has been very supportive, number one, by creating the enabling environment and the policies to enable entrepreneurs, especially indigenous entrepreneurs, to strive. Now the onus is on us to make sure that we seize that opportunity. So I'm calling on all Gambians, you know, to seize this opportunity. You know, the environment in the Gambia, you know, is peaceful, number one. You can do your business peacefully, it's secure, and the government of the country is open. If you have any issues, you can always access them. The ministers have access to them, even the president. You know, people write letters to him and he reads them and he replies to them. So that means that he wants to encourage people to input their quota. So for me, I think, and for the group, we must just say that we think that the Gambia has the right environment for businesses to strive. Now it's up to you as a youth or as a businessman to seize those opportunities.
One of the most prominent Gambian business executives has spoken his mind about the critical period and the subsequent years that saw their business blossom. For others, it's a unique moment to digest the lessons and take it to the next level.
Well, they are highly ambitious. They are determined to make sure that they get the word across to the general public. The young people in the media recently showed a video which is aimed at highlighting issues that are affecting young people and trying to suggest ways of resolving them. Kumbaba picks up the rest of that story.
The network of young people in the media are putting in effective strategies to create awareness in homes and schools to promote children's rights as part of their outreach programs.
Young People in the Media is an organization established by young people. It was launched by Her Excellency on the 9th of December 2006. So most of the things we do is to create a platform for young people from different backgrounds to come to a common platform to discuss issues affecting them.
The video entitled 60 Seconds, filmed in 2014, depicts some of the major challenges facing young people in the Gambia. The vice president of YPM used the opportunity to highlight key issues captured in the video.
If you look at the videos, they are not videos that were only based in the country here. They went globally. In fact, if you go on YouTube, you'll find some of the videos there. So these are things that will motivate other young people, because that year we're talking about equity. So these are young people who don't have the voice to be heard will be able, we like YPM is in there for those people.
60 Seconds is also meant to change hearts and minds in relation to issues that affect children. Some of these challenges include early marriage, gender-based violence, and rape.
When we take up this challenge, because like we are advocates and we advocate for the rights and responsibilities of young people, so this will be act as a form of participation, because young people will believe that we have a very important role to play in the society. So like coming up with this video as young people, like making this video by ourselves and coming up with these initiatives, like it's something that is very, very encouraging, so that we will be able to express our feelings through this video, this short video, so that people out there will understand that these are the things that are happening to young people, and so that we can showcase what is really happening to them, so to us.
Members of the young people in the media have observed that many children are forced into marriage as a result of poverty. They also felt that more efforts are needed to address some of these main challenges.
This video is something that is very, very encouraging. And it is the main purpose for it is to motivate young people, but also the video will actually help stakeholders and our parents, the people that are actually taking care of young people, to protect them more. Because if they see these things that are happening to the society, they'll be able to open up their eyes and see that like this is what young people face. So they will put in more effort in supporting their children and the people that they guide, all of under the young people category.
By making a captivating video on issues that affect the development of children, the young people in the media have taken a bold step in sensitizing the masses about what they need to know and what should be done to address the issue.
Well, instead of spending colossal sums of money in the name of going to Europe through the back way, there are some young people in the country who are determined against all odds to stay put and do something meaningful. We recently caught up with organizers of a dancing competition. Their aim is to at least reward the best dancer with a staggering $30,000. Rahibite reports.
Unless you have the chance to see them perform, you won't believe it. This was the impression Marisok had when she was invited to grace an event where raw talents, mostly from Gambian youths, were exhibited. The idea, according to this Gambian, is to help the youth concentrate on things that will take them to the next level and not to embark on the back way to Europe. Having been out of the country for some time, Marie returned home recently only to witness things that she thought could be improved. In the area of entertainment, Marie is working side by side with Don Easy to reward youths who can dance, instead of giving the youths the chance to engage in very risky ventures such as spending hard-earned monies to Europe. Marie thinks there are other worthy projects to be executed. It is a partnership that has other stakeholders as well, and the stakes are high. The youths on their part in an unbeat mood. For them, person is the byword. The best dancer in this contest could go home with a staggering $30,000, Who knows, this could help them start a small business venture instead of throwing away their monies on the back way to Europe.
Well, to many people, this song may not be entirely new to them. However, there is a myth surrounding the folktale relating to Kadi Kebe. Amadou Diallo picks up the rest of the story and tells us how the storm being generated about the folktale is being seen by other people.
Doing what he does best, Jeling Alimbay narrates a rendition of the story of Kadi Kebe, a woman whose story, as foretold by Mandinka Griots before him, evokes deep sentiments and profound grief at the sudden death of a woman who epitomizes true beauty and had a good and charming personality that endeared her to everyone in the village of Tunjina. Over time, this story remained undisputed and established itself in the folklore of the Kombos. History, as narrated by Jali Baba Jabade of Casamance, spoke of a village beauty who was much loved and envied in her village and died a tragic death after being poisoned by an old woman during a village festival in Tunjina. This version of history is now being challenged by another griot, Jali Ngalimbay, who, accompanied by Alhaji Sajo Baro, a veteran GRTS anchor, recently traveled to Bonto to hear the version of events from family members. They met the Alkalan elders of Bonto, who all agreed that Kadi Kebe, their blood relative, was born and raised not in Tunjina as said in the Koran narration. According to this old woman, Jenaba Kebe, who claims to be a younger sister of Kadi Kebe, the old narration contains fundamental deficiencies which ignores basic facts about the origins and life of her sister. Jenaba recalled that Kadi Kebe was born in Faraba, grew up in Bonto, but later got married to one Dambu Nsane in Tunjina, all in the Kombo East. She, however, agreed that Kadi Kebe was a beautiful, famous and good-natured girl. Was said that she died when giving birth to a child in Tunjina. She wondered how Jali Baba Jabare came to his conclusions about Kadi Kebe dying as a result of poisoning after sneaking to meet her boyfriend. Such claims, she said, is an insult to the memory of her sister and family. Modu Lamin Kebe, the alcalde of Bonto, equally expressed dismay with such a narration and rubbished it as fiction, saying it is mere imagination by the griot who is an accomplished storyteller. The most disappointing thing the alcalde fumed is that the story continued even though the family repeatedly set the record straight. He expressed hope that things will change now this version will be heard. The Imam of Tunjina and one Musu Kebe, who claims to be a niece-in-law to the late Kadi Kebe, both corroborated Jenaba's version. Musu said Kadi Kebe was happily married to her uncle, but died in labor. This, he said, she can vividly remember as a young girl. This endeavor by the respected Jali Ngali is just another twist to the famous and never-ending Kadi Kebe saga. By talking to family members and close relatives, he is hoping to challenge the existing version of history, which has been widely accepted to be true in the Kombos. The challenge for now for him is to match or outperform the skills of Jali Baba Jabate, whose rendition continues to touch the hearts and evoke the sentiments of traditional music lovers.
Well, Weekend Spectrum now goes for a short break. We'll be back. Well, over now to our Gay, who has been monitoring events that are trending in town regarding the next Senegambian model.
I welcome you all to the Senegambian Next Supermodel 2016. Please stay tuned, don't go away. Very soon, you are going to see talents, you're going to see some very good models. But then, it's not only Gambians, we have some Senegalese too, and we also have some people from Guinea-Bissau. Please don't go away, don't touch that remote. This is the Weekend Spectrum, and I am your host, Awagay Cisse.
When I was called to do this, there's a large number of girls that are running for this one title. And the amazing thing is Senegambia is one. And Senegambia, in a sense, we all have, you know, Guinea-Bissau, we have, you know, and we have Senegal, and also all the other countries.
countries that are around that are competing for this. So it's actually an amazing thing that we're here to share in this great
day. Yeah, my name is Vic Chibola. I'm a student and I'm also a model. Today we are at St. Gambia's Next Supermodel casting, and I happen to be a judge today, which is actually amazing. Because 2 years back I was in this position, and it's a great honor to do this. And the casting has been going fine so far. Some girls have been dropped and some girls have been selected. My message to the girls that have been selected is congratulations and keep doing what you do. And for the girls that have been dropped, don't give up, it's not the end. Because I remember personally I was dropped so many times.
Hello, my name is Fana Kamara French and I'm 22 years of age. I live in Tranquil with my husband.
Okay, it's like you're one of the organizers.
Yes. The reasons of organizing this event is to promote young Gambians, you know, the youths, because we know that there are so many beautiful girls out there, you know, who have the talents, but they don't have the opportunity to show out what they've got. Winning prize is $50,000, see, and today is the first audition. The 26th of March, we're having the second audition, and the 2nd of April, we're having the final audition. But the event itself is the 4th of June 2016. Not only Gambians are participating, but Senegal, Mali, and Guinea-Bissau. Yes, they're also part of the Senegambian Next Supermodel. Gambian, you are Gambian, we are Gambian. We can all do it. So let's come out and support. It's gonna be okay. See you in the second audition. Thank you.
Well, from Awagay, I decided to meet one Indian adventurer who is determined to travel country by country with a view to spreading peace and HIV/AIDS messages. Here is more.
His story is not entirely new to many people. After all, this Indian adventurer is rather on an ambitious mission to reach out to 190 countries. With his ordinary bike, Somnen Nebnat said he has had difficulties and unforgettable experiences on his journey that began from an unknowable village in India in May 2004. A knowledgeable young man whose inspiration is to discover the world and preach the message of peace and healthy living. He has a burning desire to change minds, especially on issues relating to segregation for those living with HIV and AIDS.
The risk is coming, like I was 6 times robbed, 8 times was beaten by people. And more than, so I don't take it, you know, like a big problem. It is some way of difficulties, and in this world, not all people are the same. Although I'm passing a message of peace and harmony, and also promoting with Indian culture and youth and sports with HIV/AIDS awareness. So this means that I have to be more kind when I'm coming to a country. I cannot complain if I'm a guest. So that's always I keep in my mind and try to connect and to cooperate with the people. That is the best way to how I can learn positively.
Riding a bike from one country to the other, Somnen Nebnat said, for now he doesn't think about marital life. The world over the years has become his family. It is a mission he's determined to complete in 2020.
Actually, when I will 2020 finish this journey, I consider that whole world my family. So I'm writing my book, 16 Years Around the World Biking Odyssey, and that book will remain the people, experience and memory. With that, my future plan to build a global village, and that village will build it in India, which will be the global village, means it is people village. And during this travel, almost 20 million people I'll meet. So these 20 million people who are part of my family, they could say that we have a village, we have a home in this world. So this village will be 8 hectare land, 4 hectare for accommodation and 4 hectare for food. So all fruit and coming should come from that village, and it will be ecological and sustainable village. So where we will live with peace, love and humanity, so that we can try to support each other to build and to think that we are one world and we should live together with dignity, love and peace.
At the end of the mission, this Indian adventurer said he would construct a global village, but that is not done yet until he attained the target he set for himself in 4 years' time.
Well, traveling around the world with a bike can be a dangerous undertaking. But however, this Indian man is determined against all odds to face the risks and complete his mission on good time. Well, this also tells you that an Indian can be anything. If a Chinese man can go to the moon, or a Russian, or any other nationality, why not an Indian man? Often, India is referred to as the incredible continent, because with India, the possibilities are limitless. Well, this is where we draw the curtain for this segment of our program called Story of the Week with the Indian adventurer, Soman. We wish him all the best.
Thank you so much.
Of luck.
Thank
in your
you.
Endeavors.
Thank you.
Dhanyawad.
Dhanyawad.